existed in the first 3 minutes. In the 2v2, Uzi and Ming absolutely crushed Sneaky and Zazel. So that has to be at the back of the mind, at least, of the Cloud9 AD carry.
And let's see what comes through. Of course, World Never Give Up have first pick here. They chose blue side, and the bans come through. Svenskeren staying in the lineup. They are removing some of those high damage range junglers from the C9 backside. Talia, Kindred both away. No playmaking for Xiaohu. And keep in mind, the mid lane bans have to be shifted around because of counterpick. Jensen can guarantee himself the best possible matchup. And RNG, I want to see what they try to get rid of to ensure that doesn't go too bad.
I like that, the respect towards the Shen pick. Both Urgot and Aatrox are both available, and you would imagine that RNG will look to first pick the Urgot once again, just like they did last time, and say, you know what, you don't have your Shen counterpick this time around.
There's still so much up. There's Zaya, Alistar, Rakan, everything's still available right now. If RNG once again take the Zaya first pick, does that force Cloud9 therefore to try and split up the Lovers duo? Feel like this is a blue side draft on a patch where, red side has been stepping up.
Now, of course, Nocturne is a very big MLXG champion. He even brought it out back at MSI when no one was considering it, but has it now here in the decider for the first seed out of the group to dodge some of the incredibly scary teams in those other parts of the bracket. C9, what are they going to look for here?
And if we look at MLXG's original arrival into the LPL when he started surprising people, it was picking strange champions and then doing strange things. You know, Nocturne, he doesn't gank before level 6. Why is this guy down in my bottom lane? Oh, I'm dead because I overextended. So I really do think that whilst it is a pick, you can expect the farm to 6 playstyle. Don't underestimate the fact that he will still play a very aggressive early game.
So Cloud9, what are they going to look for here? Is it the dedicated jungler in Lee Sin or Graves? And will it be the Rakan later on? Does that get stolen away by RNG? Lots of questions to answer in this draft as time ticks down. And no, they will look for Thresh, for early playmaking, or ways to save against the Nocturne.
So I think that's why RNG left it up, because they're basically saying, listen, you're actually going to put way more priority on getting the Zaya Rakan bot lane, because if you don't, then we're just going to steal one of the components away from you, or we're going to pick Thresh into it. We've already shown that we can play it. So Cloud9 are then going to the next level of thinking and saying, well, you know what? If we take the Thresh off the board, what have you got left? Shen is taken away. Alistar's taken away. Tahm Kench is taken away.
Ooh.
We feel we can get a really strong 2v2 if we just guarantee this Azazel now.
Nautilus is still up and available. We have seen it throughout the tournament as the answer to this. Maybe they just play homage to the eliminated LCK team, pick themselves up, something up like a ranged support to try and bully the lane. I think that there is still options down there in the support position.
And of course, they get the chance to grab Aatrox. So is it the Hecarim snap call?
Yeah, is it? That's the big question for me. Now, I will say that while I do like the pick when it's in Licorice's hands, Cloud9 did draft a 1-3-1 star earlier and weren't able to play towards that strength. So if they do want to go for it again, I hope that they go more towards the teamfight angle. That seems to be more of their strength so far in the second round of this group.
Zaya, of course, a great team fighter and arguably a much better one than this Lucian. And they're going to go ahead and quickly take up the Zillion. Now, keep in mind, Aatrox is flexible. We've seen plenty of Aatrox mid here. And I'm still waiting for Lucian mid to come out. I feel like that's actually a decent matchup in a Zillion in particular. But we'll wait to see, of course. I don't expect to see any bot lane bans, but mid lane bans instead, as Jensen more or less blinds the Zillion.
And I wonder how far they attack Xiaohu's champion pool, because whilst Nocturne can be creative in the early game, you don't expect him to go towards the mid lane. I would expect that this could be a 1-3 comp, one comp coming out of RNG. Whilst Lucian doesn't lend itself towards that, they do have the ability now to drag Zillion into a side lane, which Zillion does not want to be able to do. So I think that there are a lot of options open to RNG. On the flip side, I think Cloud9 just must stick with the team fighting, the death ball, the ability to get everyone on the same page and then counterattack brilliantly, as we've seen throughout today's play.
Keeping my eyes on how RNG round this out as well, because it looks like they're taking top lanes off the ball. There's the Hecarim that we were just talking about. Do Cloud9 now go for the Lissandra that they've shown before?
Akali?
Do they have something new? Yeah, exactly that. They already have the Zillion in the mid. They could do with a little bit more engage in their composition right now, because outside of the Thresh, you don't really have that many ways to start up fights. I like the synergy between a Zillion and a Xin Zhao, and I think it does give you some early playmaking potential to enable you to play through your bot lane.
Thorn seems a bit likely here, maybe even the Sion as well, but a dedicated tank top laner I think does make sense. Zillion doesn't really seem like a 1-3-1 kind of character, and though you can probably defend mid lane with Zaya Thresh without too many difficulties, I do expect the tank to play hard, engage, to dive out of the back line, But we'll see. If RNG have too many threats, someone else can carry the load. And there is that Rakan picked up to round out the bottom lane of RNG.
And now they're just waiting on Xiaohu's pick. And does he go towards something like a Syndra and try and once again shove in the lane early, start trying to pressure? Not all that great into Zilean as the game progresses just because of the revive passive, but would still free up some aggression down into this bottom lane.
I still wonder if they go Kai'Sa and move that Lucian around. We'll see. 3 seconds to go. No, Syndra is going to be the grab most likely. Time goes through. It will be Lucian, Rakan bottom lane, Syndra in mid.
I really don't like this pick against Zilean. While I think that it can have value in lane, all your damage is single target. And throwing that onto a single member is very easy for Zilean to say, well, you know what? I'm just going to save this character, revive him, and now the Syndra loses so much value in teamfights. So I feel like Xiaohu is mainly doing it for lane strength. It doesn't really complement the 1-3-1, but it will allow Royal Never Give Up to have that priority in mid, in top, and potentially down towards the bot side as well.
Yeah, Xiaohu, famously known as Angel Beats in the Chinese solo queue. LeBlanc, Syndra, his two most played champions, was a monster on that. This is arguably one of the most important games played at Worlds so far. If RNG get out at first seed, they can guarantee that they will have an easier run at the bracket stage. Whilst you could still argue they are the best team at Worlds, you want to make it as easy as possible for yourself. If you lose here, the tournament gets substantially harder.
But also, if we just think about what it means on a global scale to be knocked out of first seed by Cloud9, the North American representative, when you consider how strong RNG were considered coming in, Cloud9 could do so much in terms of their reputation and making a strong run into the World Championships. This could be such a huge deal for them if they find that upset.
I don't think North America's ever come out of the World's group stage with a number one seed out of a group. This would be a bit historic here, and it would also, I would say, threaten a lot of other teams. Ooh, if we get first seed, that's an RNG second. Ooh, that could be scary for the quarterfinal. But that's a lot of hemming and hawing for later on here. It is now time for the players on the Rift. The coaches have shook hands, and the fight for the top spot in the group of death is on the line. We know Vitality and Gen G have already fallen in third and fourth, respectively. The question is, can Cloud9 top a group that contains the MSI champion, or does RNG go exactly where they expect it to at the end of it all, in the beginning of it all, and take this first spot? We are ready to go on the Rift, ladies and gentlemen. Royal Never Give Up and Cloud9 to do battle.
And I do want to hit on the coach of C9 just for a second, because made his career in the LCK, transferred to the LPL, and became the king of the region with EDG winning MSI, now transforms a rookie C9 lineup into the potential number one seed from the group of death. So much praise has to go towards Reaper. He has given his team a very similar draft, and now it is on the players to execute.
I'm really excited for this game. We see Jensen with the Zilean pick once again. Won't have a huge amount of pressure in the early laning phase, very much what you expect. But it is a huge pick for C9 and how they like to play. It gives you so much dive potential, speeding up that Xin Zhao, allowing him to dive onto champions like the Syndra in these teamfights, giving him that revival option. That means that C9 can be very dangerous in these fights.
But that is still a whiles away. And when you are a Zilean facing off against the Syndra in the mid lane, early game threat is going to be on the side of Syndra. Svenskeren has played most of his games this year with Golden Glue. Jensen has been playing a lot with Blabber. This is the Jensen Blabber style of aggressive jungle. We have to see whether that synergy is on point, because that mid lane, at least until level 6, is heavily RNG favored.
So, you know, not trying to push the wave in early at all. Just a few autos. Now they start with it as they see Uzi and Ming here. And right away, Uzi going for some pretty big trades, and they will keep fighting back and forth as the minions start going down. But we have seen worse starts, interestingly enough, already for the C9 duo. This one, far above average.
Certainly is. It's not that bad. Talking about Lucian a little bit, one of those AD carries that is a Blade of the Ruined King rush has got a great second item spike if he goes for that Black Cleaver. And we mentioned already this mid lane.
Xiaohu hits level 2, though. This could be the time to stop for this one, as Jensen needs a single minion. Finds a bit there, the minion will fall, and he gets level 2, but there's no chase. Xiaohu pushed out to miss a bit of XP, but not too much.
So smart of Xiaohu to play towards the top side, because he had... Well, actually, typically you play towards where you have vision, because you generally see the safer, but obviously he gets spotted on the bot side ward. Now we see Uzi and Ming Trying to look for a bit of a trade, but smart from Xiaohu to just position in a way to not run the risk of actually running Ignite on the Syndra as well. He still wants to have that lane pressure in the middle lane, wants to take advantage of, as you said, Spawn, the weak early laning phase of the Zillion. But, you know, I just think that it's very all in for a champion that later on in the game kind of does a lot to mitigate your value in fights.
Mate, you just saw how they played against Gen G. They've picked themselves up once again.
Three very strong lanes.
I don't think he's thinking about that 35-minute team fight where he doesn't do all that much against this comp. And want to go back to, you know, the Lucian pick. It's going to have a great two-item spike. Normally, Uzi is that late-game insurance policy that they rely on. Top lane, they've got themselves a pushing lane in the form of the Aatrox as well. This could be a similar game as to what we just saw, where this isn't the Uzi show. This is the IG Trident, that three-pronged attack that is able to play so far up in the lanes.
You can see bot lane being pushed in right now. That farm is going to go to sneak without too many difficulties. Should be close to equal here, but a nice bit of damage. Licorice, Energy One has to heal right back up with that Corrupting Potion. Nice trade that'll let me as MLXG now wards to make sure he can stay safe and Svenskeren can't go for anything too scary.
And this is really cool from MLXG because we talk about it a lot, but the ability for Nocturne to AoE clear, hook is on, not much damage coming out there. And he has gone bottom side jungle clear into top side vision and will take away arguably the most experienced valuable camp on the map now outside of the major buff. And he's just accelerating himself towards that level 6 mark. So whilst not having impact on the lanes, he's doing a good job of providing vision and information and should be at level 6 earlier than expected.
And Licorice is now TP. He's already burned that to get back into lane. So if he dies, he's missing a lot if a kill does come through. Has to respect what this could be from Let Me and MLXG. But that Nocturnal Recall and he can stay safe. Checking back in the bottom lane, Uzi and Minx loving a great shot for themselves, up 8 CS so far, and not showing any signs of slowing down.
Yeah, we see this a lot when this 2v2 matchup tends to happen, sneaky behind in the laning phase, but now Svenskeren is hanging around. He has the Lantern from Zazel.
Flash is available.
Oh, that hook could have been the signal to go in, but not going to find it here. A Flay backwards is still there, and Ming got a 200 HP, going to have to kite away.
Yeah, and that's such a strange play because you feel like Ming went low already. If you do flash forward, if you commit to that play,
they're going in for Ming. Ignite is on. They've got the chases. Flashes down. Sven, he should get the knockup. And first blood goes to Cloud9.
And that's what I said. Just back yourself, young man. Go for the play. He does it. Gets first blood for his jungler. And now Cloud9 have themselves a winning lane.
And that hook almost landed. That could have been a bit more. The lasso, I should say. As C9 shoves in, they'll get themselves a pretty safe recall. Kill credit, as you mentioned, did go to the jungler. Svenskeren's going to feel happy about this one.
And a good start for Cloud9, playing around the bot lane. This is where they had issues the first time they met, and we said it earlier in the day. Sneaky and Zaze were able to mitigate the pressure, but now they've actually found themselves an early kill. Uzi?
Guardian.
Ooh.
Guardian is a pretty good rune. And if you don't deal damage with the health bar, the recall does not stop. And that is a BF sword for Sneaky. That is very crucial in what can be a very difficult laning phase against Illusion.
Exactly that. So let's see exactly how this one plays out. We're going to have Zazel throw the Lantern back, immediately flash in for the Flay, and he goes for Ming rather than for Uzi. He wants to try and shut down the squishier target. He throws the Ignite down, lower health on the Rakan, results in a very quick kill.
However, as Gold didn't go over to Sneaky for that kill and still 15 CS behind, Xiaohu gets a good trade. That is still an advantage in the bottom lane for Uzi. Also, I mean, I've talked about it a lot so far, but the smoothness of the item path for Lucian, you know, the fact that you get lifesteal as well as attack damage, you get attack speed on the first buy as well, just makes him feel a lot more comfortable in that laning phase.
Licorice on a half HP. Let Me, of course, has the ult to make trades easy, and MLXG knows he is not hatching a ward in this brush. Licorice, his way back to the lane is going to be a slow walk.
That is one of the most obvious setups I think I've ever seen, however. Tanking a full creep wave off the turret when you're that low kind of is a telegraph play, I think, on the top side of the map.
Yeah, Licorice respecting it as well, going to back away, spend a little bit more of his gold, very early armor boots. And to be fair to Cloud9, their early laning phase is going pretty well. You can see Jensen is even against the Syndra in mid. And the top side of the map, Licorice is now down 15 CS, but Let Me will go back to base, and Licorice can close that gap a little bit more. So far, the fact that the gold is slightly in favor of Cloud9 and things are going well, they're mitigating this early laning strength that RNG does have.
Yeah, and I think that the Jensen one is most impressive, and you can see now they feel like they have pressure in the mid lane.
Slow, bomb one, bomb two not going to land, and a nice pushback means that Xiaohu feels totally safe. Svenskeren might have to be a little bit careful on this one as he keeps running backwards. Is not going to be slowed, and there will be no reason to ult.
The reason Xiaohu turned around so aggressively is he saw an opportunity to pop the ultimate onto Svenskeren and guarantee Jensen had to use his ulti. That means that when the level 6 comes through now for MLXG, there's a window for them to attack Zillion and try and open up this matchup. Credit to Svenskeren, puts a dancing shoes on, actually dodges out on all that damage, means that that is not the case.
And the bonus movement speed from the Zillion makes the damage easier to get out of harm's way. So good stuff there from the Cloud9 mid jungle duo. Now we get back to bot lane, Sneaky.
Sneaky burned down to under 100 health, a nice culling. And here comes MLXG, he's found the ult, the lasso, the pullback. Sneaky stays alive, but Zazel's now alone under the turret. Will there be a dive? Jensen and Svenskeren come in to keep him alive. This poor Thresh hoping there is no dive to be had. MLXG might be found out. And how can he save himself as Sneaky's gonna find a stun from his friend? And that'll be a kill coming through to Jensen. 2-0 Cloud9.
Good stuff there from Cloud9 as they turn around the dive from RNG. Things look dire for Sneaky. I made a weird noise. He gets away with his life though. And fantastic stuff as they get a kill onto MLXG.
And I said that Casa makes them look like an LCK team. Well, boy oh boy, does MLXG make RNG look like a Chinese team again.
MLXG though, you could see what his intent was, but man, is the action over yet? Svenskeren, I think he's just trying to help the bot lane push things out. Sneaky has no mana. He doesn't want to run the risk of getting collapsed on as Ming very close to that level 6 mark.
I've loved Sven's early game. He has assisted multiple lanes. He is massaging the danger of the 3-lane push. This is another opportunity where he rotates straight to the play bottom lane. But this is initially a very nice setup for RNG.
So crucially, getting the level 6 there for Sneaky was why he was able to walk away with his life. He used the heal as well. Now MLXG is just kind of stuck in the mistake he makes is trying to turn around and getting the kill onto Sneaky. He could have walked away with his teammate. He instead does not do that. Jensen's able to collapse down and he ends up getting the kill with the bomb as well.
And whilst it's not the outcome that a lot of RNG fans would want, I think it is the outcome that RNG fans would expect when MLXG dives past the first turret.
But I still want to talk about the winning lanes that RNG have drafted. Despite the 2-0 scoreline in kills, the gold is actually favoring the LPL champions in RNG because they've been winning top lane by 20 CS, mid lane by 8, and their two camps up in the jungle as well. Not to mention Uzi and Svenskeren. Drop low, he will take the ult, and now he's got to re-engage. But will they wait it out? They might get the first kill, as Svenskeren's going to flash away, and that's the wrong timing, a trade kill on the junglers.
And Svenskeren thought that because his ultimate was up, he would actually stay alive in that situation, but I believe it just ran out at the last second. But I'm also going to assume that this pause is due to that because I saw the auto come on
through. It's a spill, apparently.
Oh, it's a spill. All right. Well, it turns out that the ulti did just run out. He did end up trading his life, and it ends up being a kill for kill in the junglers. But C9 still matching the early game of RNG, still keeping the gold fairly even. But as you said, Freak, these laners for RNG in mid and top are building those advantages. And now Xiaohu sits on a kill.
And if you're ever in doubt of, you know, how this game was going to play out, whether RNG had regained form, whether it was a flash in the frying pan out of Cloud9 that was going to fizzle. This early game has been so back and forth. We are 10 minutes in. Gold lead is dead even. There is nothing between these two teams today. And Cloud9, this time around, would argue they have the scaling on their side.
Yeah, I really do think Zai is a much better late game team fighter. And with an Nocturne dive being turned around by a Zillion, it's kind of funny how that combo works out. It's good alongside and really good against. I do like what Jensen can do in this mid lane, but it's still a very close game, and I think this can turn on a knife's edge here as soon as RNG pushes forward because the gold is equal.
It certainly could. RNG, even though they've lost a couple of kills, they're still in a good position. The early game hasn't been lost entirely. And again, we said it the last time they met, you always have to respect the team fighting potential of RNG. But saying that, C9, they did respect it and they out-team fought their opposition the last time they met.
Quick update on stage. Water in a keyboard, never a good sign. They're going to bring out a new keyboard for Svenskeren. It's going to be a couple of minutes until that one gets replaced, and hopefully he learns to keep the water in the cup or his mouth next time.
There is a sense of irony that it is a North American player that ends up spilling water on his keyboard, given that you guys, I believe, got sippy cups here for the
He NFL has one!
And he's
you can see it right there, he has a sippy cup!
For those playing at home, if you can't just get a ref to go grab you a new keyboard, put it in a container full of rice, hopefully it will start operating again the next day.
Yeah, and you can see, oof, yeah. I mean, see, that bottle, that's capped all the way. That is a sippy cup right there. And yeah.
But getting back into the game, you can see how close it is in terms of the gold. Only 10 minutes in, C9.
He's unplugged the keyboard.
What a story it has been for this team. Day one, they looked like they were going to go 0-3. Even the game against Vitality, they were losing for the majority of it.
And by all rights, they should have lost.
They got a huge comeback in the end. And then today, they go 3-0 in the group. All of the issues just seem to disappear. Zazel is performing. Licorice is still a top superstar for Cloud9. Jensen is having the games of his life, and he's getting his hands on one of his comfort picks in Zillion. And now they're in a tiebreaker for first against RNG, the two-time back-to-back LPL champions and MSI champion.
And I think we do need to address what a pause at this stage of the game does. All of a sudden, you start kind of losing track of game state. This is where the veterans probably need to step up and calm the rookies down, you know, reset the mentality going into the game. You've done such a good job already. You're 3-1 up in the kill department. You do feel like you're getting to the position of the game you need. However, this just resets all momentum, puts the game back to square one.
It maybe does a little bit. It's always curious to see what everyone's sort of mind state is at. I think this game is definitely, oh, here we go. This is the action replay. And oh, yeah, just didn't wait till it all fell back. And he's like, no, my time. Oh, he couldn't catch it. Oof, yeah.
Hate to see it happen.
You hate to see it. To recap the game, the one thing I want to say is I think this game is going well for Cloud9 based on draft. I think the lanes should all win on paper. And in fact, you look at the CS, they are. The fact those kills have come through is good X factor on C9's side, turning things around or finding those ganks. But you're still in this close game. And we know, like, you think back to that game that was just played, RNG beating Gen.G. They can turn it on and immediately make those dives.
And it comes down to the little things as well, because turrets have been pressured. Because when you're pushing in on the lane, turrets are taking chip damage. When Cloud9 wins a team fight right now, the map's just resetting, everyone's going back and shopping. If RNG wins one of these skirmishes a little bit more heavily, then they're going to take down a turret. They're going to mobilize around the map, and their champions do come online sooner in this game. Whilst Cloud9 would like where they are a disaster, one disaster away from really setting the pace of what will be a quick game for RNG if they can play it in their style.
ECA, 2 minutes till we are back ready to go on stage as Venskeren gets his computer and keyboard really ready to go. We are very soon. There is the keyboard. The cord is in his hand, and he is ready to plug it in.
Look at the mechanics.
Into the USB port. Now the lights are still off. You gotta actually plug the thing in. He hits the keys. They don't do anything yet. Yeah, it's wired. It's wired, Svenskeren. You need to put the... Now, quick, how many times do they have to try to put the USB into the port?
Ooh,
one, two, with, three, or four?
I'm going with three.
Okay.
I'm going with one.
All right.
He is a
Here's
pro.
Try number one. Oh, that's try number two. He slipped it. And I can't see because the scoreboard is in the way.
That's going to be try number three.
Oh, we're on to try number three.
Here he goes.
We all know this pain. The scoreboard is down. On try number three, he gets it.
I actually am going to DQ you. I think that's one of those keyboards that has two USB ports. I'm going to say you got the first one, try one. So I was technically correct.
Okay.
And then try number two for the second USB.
Ooh.
Yeah, that's a technicality there. The analysts will tell us after the game. But now we have the players ready to go, and the stakes, again, are incredibly high. The winner here is the number one team out of the group stage. C9 were not expected to be here. This was the group of death where RNG and Gen.G would have ruled the world. Of course, the LCK representative, Gen.G, fell very short. They're the first Korean team in 5 years to fall in the group stage. Samsung Ozone, the previous one, with that dubious honor. C9 rose to the occasion. Team Vitality did as well. And with Svenskeren in the lineup, they're hoping to also dethrone Royal Never Give Up and rip most pick'ems. C9 number one, RNG number two.
Yeah.
If that happens, of course. RNG, of course, neck and neck in this game and can easily still top this group.
So if this teaches us anything, it's that analysis doesn't help you in your pick'ems at all.
Absolutely not.
You should just roll dice and just see where it lands.
Betty,
and then...
I come to Worlds every year, and I have no idea who is going to win anymore. So I think it's at a certain point that the teams are close enough together now that on-the-day performance is really what is crucial. Preparation, you know, class of player, all those things are, you know, still factors in the lead-up. But if you do not bring your A game on the day...
Yeah.
Teams will beat you. That has been demonstrated so much.
And it is really incredible. I don't think we've ever had the world's group stage go according to predictions, according to power rank, according to regional power here. And yet we have another one. with some upsets across the board. And we are ready to go back into the game. The battle for first place in Group B is on the line. Tied in gold, Cloud9 versus Royal Never Give Up.
So yeah. Just,
okay.
You good?
Okay. Just to recap, the last thing that we saw just before the pause was that both junglers lost their lives. There's a bit of a skirmish around the middle lane, and it ended up being a one for one. But both kills went over to each respective mid laner, and you can see some crucial items starting to come through. Very early boots going in favor of Xiaohu to help dodge out on those bombs, and also the Rod of Ages very early. Important pickup for Jensen is nearing its completion.
On the flip side, however, early magic penetration against no MR is a crucial stat for a lot of burst mid laners. If Xiaohu gets a full combo into someone, they will die. At the same time, Uzi sitting on the Cutlass as well as a recurve bow. Once again, combo AD carry if he's allowed to fight these protracted kind of skirmishes in the bottom lane will come out ahead. Bottom side of the map at the moment should be on an RNG power spike.
This will be an easy blue buff transfer over to Xiaohu to allow him to continue some lane priority. That level 9 Syndra is going to be an absolute menace up there.
They're peeing on Licorice.
Yeah, they're going to try now as three are on the way over. He'll get away from that first spell, and he's just on the way back. Gets away from most of the CC. Licorice stays alive.
Just poppy things. Walk up, clear a control ward against three members of RNG, then just runs away. Absolutely nothing to be afraid of, and he is down in farm, but if you compare that to Letmi versus Cuve in the last game, where he was up around 60 CS around the 50-minute mark, you can definitely say that Licorice is having a much healthier laning phase.
Absolutely. Kills a bit better for C9 as well as we wait and look at Svenskar and camping in the mid.
Not only that, look at what Licorice is going to do for the team fight. You know, all of a sudden Ming finds a more difficult job of diving into the back line. Letmi will not be able to do that either. Even things like MLXG is going to have to be very wary of the Poppy Steadfast presence. So Licorice will dictate the pace of a lot of the late game team fights if we get to that stage.
And he's going to be an armor tank. There's three heavy physical damage dealers in Xiaohu. Not much of a tank killer on Cinder. Just not really how that kit works too well. You don't want to waste the ult there. So an armor sack Licorice will be a very big, crucial part of the team fights. RNG, honestly, low on tanks. It'll be up to Letmi using his ultimate well. And of course, he's a great player. He can do that. That's an ult on a Jensen, low health bar. No stun to land either. And they're not going to wait to go for it yet. MLXG just waiting in the wings, waiting in that brush. They don't know he's there. Xiaohu might look for another stun. He's got it up pretty soon. Here's the ult in. Does Nocturne pull the trigger? And yes, he does. Goes in, knocked back in. And now that's going to be Jensen forced to run away. That's going to be the quick resurrection. But look at Svenskar's health bar fall down. A trade of kills. Xiaohu ultless, but so is Jensen. The jungler's going down. Mid laner's getting the kill. Same as last time.
Once again, one for one around the middle lane. I feel like MLXG, he wanted to force Jensen to ult himself so they could quickly turn onto Svenskar. But he did a good job of creating a gap between himself and Xiaohu that they could throw enough damage onto MLXG to turn into a one-for-one trade. So good stuff there from Cloud9, still keeping this gold in the early game very even.
And hey, that was probably pretty well played coming out of the RNG lineup. You can just see the frustration they have with trying to deal with this Zilean. This is not a pick that you play against all that often. And once again, Uzi trying to pressure bottom lane.
And he's doing work in this bottom lane. A 40 CS lead, the turret down to half. And that's with a failed gank and a failed dive giving free assists over. They are smashing this.
And this is why a lot of people like to see a threatening Xiaohu pick, because if you isolate Uzi, he wins his own lane. It's not like you have to build comps around this guy. This guy is one of the most lane dominant carries statistically ever. And you can see that right now in a 2v2, even though there is playmaking potential on Zazel, even though Sneaky has one of the safest AD carries in the game with wave clear, they still cannot stand up to Uzi.
You bet your bottom dollar, RNG is about to get first turret in this game. Blade of the Rune King already there for Uzi, still pushing forward. MLXG to make sure top lane stays safe. And there's no threats towards Letmi.
Ooh, but there is an MLXG hanging around the top side. He's actually just going to use the pressure to secure himself the Rift Herald. Xiaohu is the one making his way up top. As you rightly said, level 11 means 2 points in the ulti. Licorice has full knowledge of this.
Well, this movement just gives them everything. By floating Xiaohu also up there, they can start the Rift Herald on the back of Jensen. He doesn't want to have to burn the teleport. So that pressure just gets them the maximum.
And you also have to wonder why C9 chose not to swap to the top side of the map. That bot tower is likely going down. Svenskar now
has to get ulted and does. That's a trade of R buttons, but still they picked up the Herald. And Now here is the Nocturne Ultimate going in for the Singe. Ults him right back out. He's trying to run away, then re-engage, but here comes Ming, and that's going to be a charm into a knockup. The Lantern is going to pull him just to safety, and it's yet again a trade of junglers. Ignite, not going to get that kill. Now here comes Lickers, but he is surrounded. It's 1v3. Snap cast the Ultimate. In come the bombs, a big stun, the flash, the kill on a Jensen, a flay to buy some time. But can the kills come through to C9? That lasso is huge. They give themselves one back, and the pull. Zazel can do no wrong. What a close fight.
How is that a 2-for-2 for Cloud9? That looked like that fight was well in the favor of RNG. They had everything that they could have wanted, but some clutch outplays from the C9 members allow them to trade even after Ming's arrival in the river.
However, because of the area it was fought, once again, Uzi didn't have to rotate. He extends that farm lead. It means they also get the Rift Herald. And if Uzi doesn't die here, that is a huge gold swing for the RNG lineup.
500 gold puts RNG in the lead. Uzi's got to run. He's got boots too. Zazel going to look for the flay, pulls him back in. But watch out, his health bar can run down. The lasso misses, and now he's got a duel yet again. The blade color is on cooldown, and Zazel's going to run. Watch out though, as MLXG gets himself the fear, and now Jensen's on the chase. They've already forced a lot of summoners out, and MLXG walks away. Well played to the RNG.
How good is this guy at AD carry? He turns around and goes on the aggression, but one more time, C9 not content with falling behind.
They're going to look for Let Me now. The damage is going to be there. He's got the flash if he needs it, but might not be able to burn it to get away. The ult's on cooldown. This will be the chase. This will be a kill. Sven Skaren finds his third.
So C9 finally find themselves a kill, but that was close from the side of Uzi. Let's go back to this skirmish up towards the Rift Hound. MLXG locks it down. Sven Skaren, he just overstays his welcome, but he knows that he has the ulti from Jensen as well. Moment that you see MLXG diving in here, you think, okay, the fight's lost, he's gonna die, not a big deal. But look at how much damage he gets off to MLXG off the back end. You combine that with the airy, the red smite burn, and the bomb, and it's enough to trade for 1-for-1.
And Freak, you already mentioned it, but Licorice at this stage of the game is exactly where he wants to be. The only person that does damage to him is the Syndra, and she's already used ultimate. She's about to die at the back end of this team fight off the great hook from Zazel. So Licorice just lives for so long and is able to walk this one out.
That was such beautiful play from the duo of Zazel and Licorice. The bomb on top of the Poppy, and now we see another fight.
We've got more fighting. This one is Licorice alone, though surrounded by so many. Could be revived. The health bar, they might wait for it. And he's going to get himself right back out. The Lantern pulls him away.
So not killing Licorice there was the right choice, because now he has to recall and he doesn't have teleport. So a numbers mismatch on Summoner's Rift might result in an RNG Drake.
Yeah, RNG, they're feeling pretty confident right now. Again, the gold is dead even though the kills is 7-4 in C9 too. Now the flash to Xiaohu.
Xiaohu's flash blitz, they're going to try. Oh, back goes the backline, but they get the first kill. Now into the 4v4, and it's fleeing. It's C9 trying to run away, but MLXG is low. Sven Skaren knocked up. What a pop-up by Ming, a 1-for-1.
But Zazel is playing these team fights so well. Hooks onto great targets. They will drop the Rift Herald, see if they can get some pressure on mid lane turret.
And it should have been RNG's option to go towards the Drake. They should have had priority, but Xiaohu, he overstays in the middle lane. He gets caught out of position. RNG, though, still gets the Rift Herald off. They get a lot of damage down. Now we see more fighting.
They are just battling constantly. This day does not disappoint. And C9 and RNG are still trading blow for blow. 300 gold lead to Royal Never Give Up. C9 yet to find a turret.
And that's what I'm thinking. The longer the game goes, the more these fights become more and more difficult to execute upon. If you focus them around something like a Baron, then it is going to get better and better for the Cloud9 lineup. You can argue things like 1-3-1 are better, but right now RNG show no tendency to play towards that style. They just want to brawl. And Cloud9 just confident in that counter-attacking play.
The crucial thing for RNG, though, is we have not yet seen Uzi in any of these fights. It has always been around MLXG, Xiaohu. Let Me has shown up in a couple. But when does the superstar AD carry make his appearance? When does he feel ready to contribute to the team's damage and be known for the strong team fighting prowess that he often provides?
Well, when he does decide to do it, he'll be insane at two items. Essence Reaver second Lucian seems to be fitting the bill here, and that is going to be basically a negative cooldown on the Relentless Pursuit. He will get so many autos off, he can shred through when he gets that item.
And the first time Uzi made his run at the World Final, it was actually on the back end of the original ice skating Lucian. That no cooldown E that you were mentioning, very familiar with the build. and should be able to put on a show here, but still the tools are there. You can see already Svenskeren picks up his second item. He is much more combat ready than someone like MLXG now, just due to the tank stats.
And one thing I want to point out is a desync in teleport cooldowns. Licorice is up in about 15 seconds. Letmi's more than a minute. This could be the signal that C9 tries to start. Their engage tool is a little bit limited, but that is a desync that matters.
Now C9 and RNG will battle around the Baron for vision. They're not going to try and force it this early into the game, but having control over that objective means it's easier to force picks. Try and look for opportunities elsewhere on the map. Speaking of picks.
He's been found out. Ignite is on. Can he get away from this, though? Zekulin comes in. Now a Lantern. And that is a great kill. MLXG puts it all the way through. This could be a big chase. Will they knock down the Nocturne? The shields keep coming in. And he's staying alive. Finally, the shutdown. And now the revive on the jungler. But they're still missing the Zaya. And Uzi can start firing for everyone. Ming getting low, but no kills just yet. Svenskeren on the run. Not going to get killed just yet. One more shot. Finally, Letmi does him in. And the chase is still continuing. Looking for another. Licorice starting to get shot, goes for a tackle, tries to get the kill. Can he get Xiaohu? He's trying, but he can't do the damage. They push him back, and they will knock down Licorice. Now it's Letmi's turn. No ulti, but the bomb is on. Getting lower, staying just alive. RNG win that fight.
RNG walk away with four members alive as C9 limp away from the battle. Big team fight that will close the kill score, and finally, RNG turn a pick into something more.
But the initial pick was without the Zillion ultimate. The fight was still protracted. You could see that it was multiple times one member of Cloud9 versus multiple. Sneaky here gets caught out. He's not going to be a factor because of a great engage coming in from Ming. Also pops over, hits the blast plan as well to stop that way out. Heads up play from Zazel. But that's 80 carry dead, and this fight is still so close.
It certainly is. You can see the damage from Jensen's bomb is a large contributing factor, but also Uzi is now in this fight, and with the damage difference from an AD carry, it's what allows RNG to just kite around these bombs, constantly dish out DPS, and while Svenskeren does what he can to try and get return kills, that's all it is for C9. Let's try and get something back. And while they came so close so many times, the shielding from Ming, the clutch healing from the Rakan as well, everything goes in favor of RNG as they only lose a single member.
And some plays by Uzi as well. He was carrying one of the bombs, dashed away to make sure Xiaohu stayed alive, did a good job there. And it's now RNG off that fight, 1,300 gold ahead. One of the pre-tournament favorites, MSI champions. Well, many people consider the best team in the world, and they are closing in on that number one seed coming out of the group of death, coming out of group B. And they are on their way now towards Baron. They've blacked out the vision. That control ward's there. It's a lantern to light that darkness for a few seconds.
And the area of the map that is currently quite strong for RNG is that top lane position. You can see it's going to be a Yomu's picked up second for Letmi. He has the staying power in these fights. He needs to be a big backline threat. However, Warmog's already done for Licorice, which goes further into shutting down that split push threat. The ability to heal up as you back off a wave is going to be big.
Pushing forward now into the top side. Sneaky down a good 40 CS under Uzi. And waiting for that second item to come through. That's an important thing, as the Essence Reaper's already done. Uzi is certainly more powerful right now, 24 minutes in. That scaling is not yet a factor on C9.
But it's still not enough that they've been able to open up the map. It's not enough that they're forcing Sneaky out of the lane in the 2v2 and taking turrets whenever they please. And this mid lane is starting to become a problem.
Jensen, though, level 15, two levels up again of his opposing mid laner. You have to start to wonder, when do you take this pick away from the man, because he constantly has strong performances on it. 3-1-4, a huge contributor to a lot of the kills for C9 so far this game. And because of his wave clear, he's providing a lot of space for Svenskeren to move into the enemy jungle, get some deep vision down. And again, we talked about it earlier, Spawn, his ultimate heavily mitigates the burst the champions like Syndra and Lucian can provide.
And we keep talking about Uzi, but it's just Jensen that's generating pressure in the mid lane. It's Jensen right now with three kills, a 30 CS advantage, and is controlling the middle portion of the map now, allowing for picks like this to come through.
Waiting in this brush, waiting for someone to walk through is Cloud9. They're not going to get it here. Now Sneaky could be running into some champions, walks into a ward. Noza got placed down. Noza has to be Ming's ward. Now they go over the wall. Here comes the dive. Sneaky gets Lantern right back out, and they've pulled an MLXG. He's got a flash away. He's slowed. The flash forward, a stopwatch to buy time, but he's certainly going to fall. Cloud9 with a huge play. Make that one happen, and they might chase forward. Svenskeren's got the haze. He's going to look for the knockout, but let me kites away.
Here comes Licorice. She's in on the flank.
But he's been found out, and Xiaohu going to be ejected from this one. A 5v3 possible dive. Licorice comes forward, looks for Uzi, forcing the flash. They've got time to hit the turret. And when is the re-engage happening? Because there's still big health bars. Svenskeren getting low, knocked up, but he can revive. And instead, the target is switched. Jensen goes down. Letby holds the front line, looking for more. Rooted, will they wait it out? Can they find the kill? But first, Uzi gets the second. RNG win that fight.
Great initial counterattack came out of Cloud9, but then they overstayed, they overreached, and now it is RNG looking to continue the play. Stun just misses, but it's a 2-for-1, and RNG should collect the top lane turret, equalizing that objective.
And I think what was so good for RNG was how they were able to split Cloud9 apart. Let me set his eyes immediately onto the back line.
They know how much danger they are in if this game goes late. There is still 10 seconds left on the jungler, so they just start up the Baron.
This is a huge play right now. 25, 26 minutes in. Licorice knows it's happening, but they could rush this down. C9 might not have the damage. Sneaky is ultless. Here's the TP in. This could be the fight that turns it all around. A hook onto the frontliner. Letmi's going to be jumped on. Here comes the fight. They're going to try to rush down Baron, but Letmi's gone. The spike comes through. Oh, it gets picked up by Uzi, doing the most carrying that he can. He gets over the wall, but he's been bombed, and RNG are losing every single member. It's Xiaohu against the world, wearing the buff. Jensen finds a bomb. He's gonna look for more, but he's been pushed away. And RNG survive with one Baron buff.
And that was nearly a disaster. They go for the Baron. Uzi picks it up, but only one member surviving. C9 now on the offensive.
A rightful battle for the first seed as RNG and Cloud9 go head to head. The gold is dead even. The kills are even. This was the Baron play. RNG kicked this one off. You said it, Spawn. The jungler is dead. They know they don't have the scaling on their side. They commit, but then Jensen joins the fight.
And with no outright tank, this is such a risky Baron. They dive into the backline. Ming is trying to create distance, but the Baron is wailing on the jungler. Jensen gets a second kill, and it is 31 damage. I think it went down to 18 at a point there as well. Uzi falls, Xiaohu lives, but Cloud9 starting to believe.
And MLXG didn't want to use his smite because he was afraid of the bombs from the Zillion. He couldn't calculate the damage. So as you rightly said, that could have swung so heavily in the favor of Cloud9, but they're now the ones pushing. Again, the gold is dead even. Cloud9 sit with a slight tower advantage. They're going to extend it by securing this another tier one.
And despite the 1,500 gold earned from Baron, you can see it's a negative Baron power play. The kills were actually worth more. And RNG did not find that way to accelerate the game. Instead, they stayed tied and added gold to both teams' pockets. A tied game again with Baron buff only on Xiaohu.
And analysts are so confident in this RNG late game that the ability that they've been so well drilled, so well trained in their class is so elite that if you take them late, you will win. But that was panic. You could see it in the eyes of the RNG members. They got out. The game's still very much a 50-50. But now with Infinity Edge, now with a three-item Zillion starting to scale up, Cloud9 feeling the comeback.
And we have to say it again. Jensen, the man in the mid lane, he is having possibly his best Worlds performance ever today.
It's not even close.
This guy is doing so well. He's getting his hands on the comfort pick, the saves he's providing, the damage he's doing with the Zillion. I've never seen a Zillion with this much damage in a game before, but now we see another fight in mid.
A huge stun, and Uzi's power spiked up. They're looking to knock down Licorice, and they cannot revive him. What a time to come alive for RNG. Wave clear for Zillion. They're going to keep the turret for now, but that was a huge pick.
And just as we tried to praise Jensen, he was not in range to provide the ulti for Licorice. He gets called out of position. RNG find themselves the pick. They still have 38 seconds left on the Baron. Let's see if they can secure anything
else.
They
might find a lot more. That hook could have been, well, the exact opposite now for C9 as they wait. They're trying to play for wards, but it is 4v5 on the map right now. This is scary to fight for. Svenskeren still holding strong, trying to play for vision, and RNG will give up a bit of control now. That was nice. The red buff steal, that should go cleanly to Uzi.
And without a teleport available on the map, it's actually MLXG that gets to go to the side lane, pick up some farm, but also take down the turret, try and extend this gold lead for RNG right now. They're in their window that they're looking for. Uzi on three items, peaked out, probably not going to accelerate at the same pace as what Zaya is now. You feel like the next 5 minutes for RNG is when they must strike.
We'll wait to see. These objectives are going to take a while to respawn now. Several minutes on both the Mountain Drake and Baron Nashor.
They haven't needed an objective to fight in the past so far.
That's true. We'll wait to see if the tower dives happen here. Cloud9 have lost their outer ring. So has Royal Never Give Up. This map has opened up slightly. Usually a good thing for a Nocturne or for a roaming champions. Like the Boots mobility on both supports here. 1,000 gold puts RNG ahead, and so far, well, we're waiting on the scaling aspect. Three items for Uzi. He's max CDR with Essence Reaver. There's going to be an insane amount of resets. Of course, Sneaky has Infinity Edge now done as well and is on a fairly similar power curve, and it only gets better for here, in my opinion, for that Zaya.
And look at where Licorice is at. He's got himself a Warmogs. He's got himself a Stone Plate. We've already mentioned he's going to be so hard to deal with as he continues to stack armor. He is a monster.
And Ben gets found out, he'll be revived. And look at the damage output. They almost knocked down Ming, but he stays up. The culling only really tickles these tanks in the front side. Ooh. And that's a health bar lead for Cloud9.
This doesn't take damage.
Yeah, that was so close from both sides. That could have been a single kill going in either way. But Ming, that flash engage to interrupt Svenskeren from grabbing the lantern was clutch. A huge punish on the mispositioning of the C9 jungler. But then Jensen with the clutch ultimate to save him. It just feels like that Cloud9 have this reset button that every time they make a small mistake, Jensen can just say, don't worry guys, we'll get another shot.
Still playing. Oh, that's a big stun. Look at the damage Xiaohu has. We've been spending a lot of time talking about Jensen, but Xiaohu in the mid lane. We said what happens when RNG stops only playing around Uzi, and their mid laner has been massive here.
And this gold range, you can see 1.7k to 600. It has been so close between the two teams with RNG mainly. But here
Stunt
we go.
Misses, the dive is in. Sven can be revived, and he's going to walk up. Uzi's going to give him that respect. Now waiting for the re-engage in the 5v5, full health. But look at Sneaky getting chucked down. In comes Nocturne, but he can't find the right target. Here he comes, and just barely gets it up in the air, and that's GA down. Once again, a 5v5 waiting for the next little moment, and the bomb will not kill MLXG. He'll stay alive through that one, but is chunked down.
Why will no one die? C9 have the ultimate from Zillion, the GA from MLXG. Such close fights again, all around the mid lane. Over real, no objective, just teams trying to find a pick, but it doesn't result in anything.
But it is tools being expended by RNG. That is the GA down now, so MLXG cannot be that aggressive, but every single time it is just a Zillion ult and a disengage that is doing the trick for C9.
And the C9 cooldowns are shorter, so still down 1,000 gold. They're in a pretty decent spot. However, Letmi trying to wedge this map open, split pushing the bot lane. No one is yet answering. Licorice does not have TP.
And that was a crucial cooldown that was used. It was Licorice's TP. That's what they made the play for, to try and secure a map pressure advantage. Jensen, whilst he also has a teleport available, wants to be there when the fight starts. Otherwise, a squishy dies and RNG runs away with it.
And you know Ming is looking. He's got the ulti. No flash, but he can get in at any time.
Let's also look at some of the items that have been picked up as well, because you can see three items now for Seeky, 3.5 for Uzi. These two AD carries are reaching that point in the game where I believe the crit really starts to outscale the Lucian, but at the same time, his mobility, that speedy, glidey Lucian that becomes impossible to touch,
Ooh. He
is there. He's primed and ready to go. Xiaohu is three items. The same can be said for Jensen, as he's almost completed that Rabadon's death cap. All of these big item spikes are coming in. We're expecting these clutch team fights, and now the Baron is alive.
And damage is relevant, but when you look at who Sneaky gets to hit with the crit build versus what Uzi has to try and kill on the front line, sometimes it's just not about the DPS race. Sometimes it's about how tanky the tank is at the front line. And Uzi right now, he would be feeling it, but unfortunately, Licorice does not feel that.
The 5v5s might be hard for RNG, but they have been playing open maps well overall. They had Letmi shoving in the bot lane. In fact, that lane is still going well, and MLXG is pretty safe to solo this Mountain Drake. So little edges going over the way of the LPL winners. And now it's going to be yet another tackle. Looking for the play, but a charm into the way out. That is an ulti down.
Certainly is, and I like the fact that they're ticking over the Mountain Drake, because once again, they don't want to go super late game. Elder gives them another area to play around, but now that it has gone off, that siren that the Drake was taken, it does allow the aggressive positioning around Baron.
Exactly that, Swarn. Cloud9 have been able to move into the river. They can sweep out the vision. They have control over mid, but most importantly, They also have pushing waves on the side. Top is pushing in, bot is pushing in. Uzi's not even there. Cloud9, I'd love to see them try and force a play right now as RNG are kind of scattered across the map.
Uzi back in bot yet again. That's probably rapid fire cannon done. He keeps spiking up. That could be four major items now. As Xenon keep playing for vision, keep playing for fog of war. And another ward comes down for MLXG. They are starting up Baron. Cloud9 looking to rush this one down. MLXG, he knows, but he has no ult target. And now he does yet again as they walk into vision. This could be the fight that determines it all. They find the knockup. They're going to knock down Letmi. He doesn't get to ult. The Aatrox is dead.
And now it comes down to the steal. Can MLXG do it?
And can Z9 zone him out? Cullen comes across. Zazel's down to 1,000. Watch out for Xiaohu. There are carries. No ult's gonna land for Licorice. 4K on the Baron.
Let's
jump forward. Looking for the kill into Uzi. But he's gonna survive. He's gonna walk away in the same place as so many years ago. And under the back line goes MLXG. Ming is down. They trade for only Thresh. And the revives come through. Huge damage out of Xiaohu in the side. But Uzi is down. Uzi is down. And it's 3v1 on the map.
And Cloud9 win the team fight off a huge pick. On to Letmi. Zazel, you beast of a man, land exactly what you need to. But now, what does C9 do? They don't want to keep pushing, they have their eyes set. Will they go for the Baron? They don't have a jungler.
They don't have a jungler, and there is 5 seconds left on Letmi. Teleport is available. Ooh. There are wards there, and they start it off.
This is a danger. Xiaohu can walk over. He is scary. And of course, Letmi has teleport, but right now, it's going to be used, and that's going to be canceled. Now, the bombs came in, but that is all C9 got off that fight. They got a TP force.
And this is the best-case scenario for RNG, because that fight could have ended abysmally if C9 get the Baron. Suddenly, they're forced into defending their half of the base. This Cloud9 comp is reaching an ultimatum point where RNG will have no answer for it.
10 stacks on the Dark Seal, death cap on the way. We have a look at how it all began. They wanted to get vision for MLXG. He needs to be able to get into these fights. Letmi, whilst not a tank, is the tankiest member, but he gets blown up. No ultimate used. And Zazel, every hook just seems to land.
And all Cloud9 are waiting for is the engage from RNG. It's crucial that Licorice misses this ultimate here, and because he doesn't knock away any of the damage dealers. If he gets Xiaohu out, they can try and get onto Uzi, but he isn't able to do it. And then here, Uzi jumps in, the rest of the team collapse. But look at what Xiaohu's doing on the side, threatening the backline. He's gonna get a multi-man stun off while Cloud9 are funneled into this choke point. And if it wasn't for his impact in this fight, it could have gone so much worse for RNG.
And yet it was still devastating. That is still four members dead, and the positioning on the map hasn't changed. They still want the Baron.
And they've created fog of war across the whole thing. RNG has no wave to push with in mid. They can't really feign an attack on towards the base just yet. The gold still just tied. Four items on both now. Mercurial Scimitar done for Sneaky. And let's see this fight come forward yet again. Levels getting up higher and higher. And RNG being pushed off the mid lane. Nocturne still waiting in the wings. So you don't have to clear this wave out.
Tension between the two teams, a battle for first in Group B. The ability to have an arguably easier time in the quarterfinals is on the line here as C9 once again kick off the Baron.
And there is the channel.
Two.
He's sent away three. And is there a chance they could steal? MLXG is still around. And ultimately, the Licorice ult means nothing. They're still waiting around Baron.
In they
go. Flash forward, looking for the kill. The cooling is on. Zazel's gone. Time for the re-engage. 5v4. RNG on the chase. Into the back line goes MLXG. And it's Sneaky just staying alive. But
they
the kills come through. They've already got three. A single trade. And Svenskeren falls. A triple for Uzi. What a carry.
And RNG says, you have the comp, we are the best team in the world. They take the team fight and they will push down mid lane.
RNG demonstrate once again why they are so good at these late game team fights.
Look how much time they have. Minions be damned, there's 30 seconds on the respawn timers. They should not need any more to close this game out. They fought tooth and nail. Royal are battered and bruised, but they will come out of the group of death as the first seed. They will shatter Cloud9's base. They will await their quarterfinal opponents, and it is up to Zazel to defend against the army, and it will not happen. RNG will make it true, and they will take the seed.
And a huge performance for Royal to regain their throne as the number one seed in the group. But that is a second seed team that you do not want to play in the quarterfinal. Hats off to Cloud9 for making the impressive run.
And you have to give the shout out to Ming and his engage at the very end. This man has been finding constant picks throughout the game, but it was that final one around the Baron that solidified the teamfight victory for RNG. So close, 19-19 was the final kill score at the end of it. The gold was dead even for the majority of the game. A single fight.